As we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for compassion so amazing. Lord, we've come to give you thanks for all you've done. If you know this chorus, sing it with me. Ready? Because of your love, we're forgiven. Isn't that a good word? Come on. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. Songs of freedom, oh, forever we're changed. Say this with me. Because of your love. Amen. Here we go. One, two, three. Here we go. Sing it together.
As we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for your passion so amazing. Lord, we come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love,
here we go.
As we come into your presence,
sing it.
We remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for your passion so amazing. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed. Because of your
love. Let's sing that chorus a cappella. Here we go. Ready?
Because of your love, we're forgiven.
Yeah.
Because of your love, our hearts are clean.
Here we go. Kick it in, boys.
We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed. Because of your love.
Yeah, give your father a hand today. We are going to start in the baptismal waters again today. Would you have a seat, please? This is our children's pastor, Brother Ken.
Good morning.
Callie
has the confidence that if she were to die today, she would spend eternity in heaven. If she were to die and stand before God, and God were to say, "Why should I let you into heaven?" She says, "Because You have called me and gave me a gift, and I accepted the gift, and I believe in you, and you are now my Lord and Savior. As best she recalls, this took place during worship at church camp when she was 9. And when she thinks about that important event, she remembers that I accepted Christ. Since then, she sees God working, helping her to be more honest to others and to believe in him for eternity. Amen. Callie, have you put your faith and trust in Jesus and him alone for your salvation?
Yes.
And you desire to follow him as your Lord?
Yes.
Callie, upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it is my joy to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, risen to walk in newness of life.
Cole.
All right, this is Cole Costello, and he has the confidence that if he were to die today, he would spend eternity in heaven. If he were to die today and stand before God, and God were to say, "Why should I let you into heaven?" He says, "Because I put my faith and trust in Jesus. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins." As best he recalls, this took place at a VBS in Dallas when he was 8 years of age. When he thinks about that important event, he remembers how happy he was to put faith and trust in Jesus. Since he's received Christ, he sees God working, making me a better person and making my life better and making me closer to him. He was scripturally baptized at Central Baptist Church at the age of 10. And some of the people who God used to bring him to Christ are my family and everyone at the church. Cole, have you put your faith and trust in Jesus?
Yes, sir.
You desire to follow him as your Lord?
Yes, sir.
Called upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Savior and Lord, it is my joy to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, risen to walk in the newness of life.
Amen. That is a wonderful way to start the service. The last 6 weeks, we have seen people following God in obedience through their testimony of faith and baptism, through baptism. And what a wonderful way. God is doing an amazing thing here right now, and we just want that to continue. I hope we start the service that way every week. Amen?
Amen.
Welcome this morning. We're glad that you're here. If you're a guest with us for the first time, we're so happy to have you, and we want to you to worship along with us. We would love to get to know you after the service is over. My wife, Kim, and I will be in the back in the foyer. We'd love to greet you. There's a guest card in the pew in front of you. You can fill that out. Give us some information. We'd be able to connect with you and contact you and help answer any questions you might have, help you figure out how to get involved in our church. And there's lots of things going on. You can see in your worship guide right now, Bible studies that are starting up. Make note of those. But because we're the music guys, I can make this announcement because Brother Charlie's not doing it here. Choirs are starting back up. We got children's choir starting up this Wednesday. So if you've not signed up for children's choir, even if you were in it last time, sign up again. And then come Wednesday at 5, adult choir starts back September 6th. Y'all need to sign up too.
Yay.
No, just teasing. But yeah, you're welcome. If you want to join the adult choir, you come there on September 6th. We're going to have a good time. Amen.
Amen.
I think that's about it. We're going to worship.
We are. Tell
Praise
them.
The Lord.
Our pastor is out today on a trip, and he and Paulette are fine, and they're good. They're just away today, so you pray for them that they have a relaxing time. We get to hear from Brother Paul Walker today. He's going to preach for us. So let's stand together as we continue to worship, please.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
All right, say this loud. Ready?
Who the Son sets free, holds me free indeed. I'm a child of God.
Love to hear y'all sing. What's next? I forgot. There it is. I cast my mind, sing with me, to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb.
The entrance sealed
by heavy the sigh is still and all alone. All right, take a deep breath and let this sing. Ready?
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will see.
The blazing sun will pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus. yourself. Here we go.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God.
Woo, sing it.
Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, oh Lord. I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Sing it with me, church.
Till every dying and every mind. Cause I know there is peace within your presence.
What we did.
I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus,
yeah.
Till every dark addiction starts to break. Desiring there is hope and there is freedom.
There is freedom.
I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Good, lead it, come on.
Over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, shout Jesus for us. To heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Can you sing that again? When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing.
All right, one more. Here we go.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives,
what is it?
All fear is gone. Because I know
Amen. All right. You may be seated. Choir may be dismissed. Musicians and singers can go. Paul, come on, brother. Thank y'all for worshiping with us today. Paul told me to go as long as I wanted to. That's all I wanted, Paul, right there.
He could have kept going. He got me ready to sing Brother Bridges, and then at that point, they won't hear me preach, so... You should have kept going. Oh, man. Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Let's worship some more, amen. Turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. And we're going to pick it up in verse 1. I'll be reading from the New King James Version, but Matthew chapter 6. Starting in verse 1. Jesus is talking and he's telling them to, in verse 1, take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the streets, that they may have glory from men. Assuredly, I say to you that they have their reward. But you, when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. Verse 5 says, and when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the street, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut the door, pray to your Father who is in secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you need before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray. Church, will you pray with me? Father, we just thank you. In the words of our pastor, God, I'm so glad to have a guy like you on a day like today. Where you, God, you're greater than our thoughts, our fears, our worries, our concerns. God, we're so thankful just to have you here in this place. But Lord God, thank you for allowing us to be here. For God, this is your home. This is your house. This is your place. Lord, we ask that your presence just be made known in here. That you would settle down and make yourself comfortable, God. That you would move in here like a mighty wind, Heavenly Father. That we would see lives change, hearts open, that things would be different, Lord God. Dear Jesus, I pray for your people that are listening to the sound of my voice, Lord, that they wouldn't hear me, that they would only hear you, Lord, that you would put me behind your cross, that I would only say what you'd have me say, Lord God. Don't allow my commentary or my jokes to get in the way. But Lord God, I pray, Lord, that you would give me the words to say in this hour. Lord, I openly admit that you are the vine and I'm the branch, and I can't do anything without you. But Heavenly Father, I believe that your word says that with you, all things are possible. So God, I pray, Lord, that you would enable this man's efforts. That you have blessed us this hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If I had to put a title on this, if I could put a title on it, I'd call it effective communication. Effective communication. You know, in today's world in America, one of the biggest purchases we make, or one of the most popular purchases we make, everything's expensive, so it seems like a big purchase nowadays. Would you agree to that? But one of the most popular purchases you'll see constantly going on and on and on are cell phones. And people buy cell phones left and right. They'll go wait for the newest one out, and then they'll get it, and then they'll get that for a little bit, and they'll get another one. But something else along with cell phones, they'll have to have the right cell phone service. They'll switch from Verizon to AT&T, from AT&T to T-Mobile, then T-Mobile to Verizon to AT&T to T-Mobile, and they'll keep the same number, they just keep changing the service. And what happens is there's a trade-off, if you will, there's a constant dilemma of saying, am I getting the best reception for the price that I'm paying? That I'm paying for something, but am I getting the best signal back based off of what I'm paying? And what I'm paying, is it worth the reception that I'm getting back? You see this constantly in these commercials from the guy named Paul. Can you hear me now? Because there's no point of having the best phone if I can't hear what somebody else has to say. Or there's no point of having the best phone if they can't hear what I have to say. So the phone is only as good as the service that is being provided on. Would you agree to that? There's a pastor that shared something with me. He said there was a man that was going through some issues, and he said, like most men, the issues were at home. And so he goes to the man, he says, what should I do? He said, well, I got a guy for you. So he goes to the guy, and he speaks to him, and he says, what's going on? He said, I don't know how to say this, but my wife doesn't hear me anymore. He says, well, you mean, like, are you talking about nonsense? He said, no, really, she can't hear me anymore. He said, okay. Well, I am a hearing doctor, so let's get this looked at. He said, so when you go home, he said, how bad is it? He said, oh, it's real bad, doc. He said, well, how bad is real bad? He said, I don't know, it's just bad. So he says, okay, I want you to stand about 20 feet off from him. And when he says about 20 feet off from him, just ask him, say, hey, how was your day? And he says, well, what if she doesn't respond? He said, then go in about 5 more feet and then ask her, hey, how was your day? And if he doesn't respond to that, go about 5 more feet in and say, ask her, how was your day? Then if that doesn't work the fourth time, he said, just go up to her ear and just ask her, how was her day? That way I'll know, as the doctor, how bad her hearing loss is. He said, okay, I can do that. That's no problem. I can do that, doctor. I can do that. So he's excited. He drives home. He gets to she's cooking. He said, okay, this is a win-win, right? You know, I get to fix her problem. At the same time, I get a meal to put in my stomach. So he says, you know what? 20 feet out, how was your day? No response. So he goes about 5 feet in, she says, how was your day? Still nothing. Now 10 feet in, he says, sweetheart, how was your day? Still nothing. So he just goes up to her ear and says, how was your day? And she responds, for the fourth time, I said the day was good. Sometimes the problem isn't the other person. Sometimes the problem is us. Effective communication. In order for us to communicate, I have to be both willing to speak, but also be willing to listen and hear. I believe, church, that sometimes in our prayer life, we say, God, you're not hearing what I have to say. And God said, no, you're not listening to what I'm telling you. Have you been there? To where God said, I'm speaking, but you're not in a place to hear, to get reception based off of what I'm trying to tell you to do. I believe the Word of God today is going to help us get the right reception to put us in a place where we can unclog our ears to hear what God has for us. So if we're going to unclog our ears, the first thing we have to do is look at Scripture here. Look at verse 5, and I believe the Bible says if we're going to be someone that's going to hear God, we got to first be a genuine person. We have to first be a genuine person. Look at verse 5. Jesus is telling the people, says, now, and when you pray, you should not pray like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the street, that they may be seen by men. And I say to you, surely they have their reward. You know, thinking about a genuine person, I have to say a genuine person in my words would be something, I have this in my notes, is an authentic person. And two things about someone who's authentic in their prayer life is, first of all, number one, is someone who decides who they want them to hear. Excuse me. Who do they want them, who they want themselves to be heard by? See, a genuine person is someone to be authentic. In my opinion, a genuine person is not just an actor, but someone who truly wants to hear the voice of God. It's one thing to say, I want to hear God, but it's another thing to genuinely feel that way. And when you say that, when the Bible, Jesus uses the word, says, and when you pray, you shall not be like a hypocrite. A hypocrite is someone that says one thing, but does something truly different. It's like they put on a facade, a mask, a show. There's an audience, if you will. They become an actor on the scene. As believers, we have to be genuine people. We have to be someone that leaves the Hollywood life behind us. You know, actors have the intention on putting on a performance for their audience. That's their goal. That's their job. But, you know, being an actor, it's a full-time job. It's a lot of work. They go to school. They practice. They spend time doing what they have to do. You know, one of my favorite movies is the Pirates of the Caribbean. You might not like it. Kenesha doesn't like it, but I love it. So when it's on, move, let me watch my movie. And I watched Johnny Depp, and I did some research on that movie. And, you know, he practiced that role for 6 months, but not just on the film set, while he was at home, while he was with his family, while he's putting his kids to bed. Every day of every moment, he was portraying this character. And all of them do that. You know, the sad part about it is, when you do that for so long, it's hard to turn it off. In our prayer life, you say, Brother Paul, how do I know, is this genuinely who I am? Because the danger of playing a character so long is that you become stuck in that character and you start identifying yourself as that person. You say, God, I'm not hearing you, but God's saying, wait a minute, who are you audiencing for? So you have to decide on who you want to hear, but then you have to dedicate your heart. The Bible says, and it says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So I would say to you that if what comes out of the mouth is from the heart, then I would say what goes to the heart is from the ears. Can I say that one more time? If the Bible says, from the out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, then I would say, if what comes from the heart comes out the mouth, then what goes to the heart comes through the ears. We have to be careful who we listen to. Therefore, we have to decide on who we want to hear from. If we're going to be careful who we're going to listen to, we have to decide on who we want to hear from. Matthew 6 says this, verse 24, that no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, which in the Amplified version gives quotation marks to say money, pleasure, fame, status, whatever is valued more than the Lord. If you value the audience of men more than you value the one God, then we have a problem of being an actor. And sometimes that blocks the reception of being heard. You know, this stage is beautiful. Absolutely love it. I got to sit there and look at them, just feel God's presence all around us. And the seats are wonderful, aren't they? They're padded on the back and on the bottom. You know, it's organized in such a way that we could fill this room up with over 600 people. The speakers are nice. They're placed to where you even forget that they're even there. But the stage, the seats, the speakers, they make a great scene. But the scene shouldn't compete with the sound of God speaking to you. The stage is wonderful. The seats are comfortable. The speakers are placed great. And the scene is great. But it shouldn't compete with the sound of God's voice speaking to you. The audience of one. See, God is omnipresent, which means he's already present to hear what you have to pray. He doesn't need to buy a ticket to your show. He's omnipotent. He's already powerful enough. He's exceedingly abundantly able to do more than we ask or think, so he doesn't even require a show. And he's omniscient, so he's all knowledgeable. He loves you enough to say yes, and at the same time loves you enough to say no. So my question to us, church, this morning is, why would we desire, decide, or demand the audience of men when God Almighty is present, powerful, and has full perception of what we need? When we pray to the audience of one. But you got to be a genuine person. But outside being a genuine person, you got to go to your garden of peace. Look at verse 6. Verse 6 says, but when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut the door, pray to your Father who's in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. The secret place. He says, when you pray, go into a room. You know, what is a garden of peace? It doesn't take very much to go somewhere and or look something up and see just there is complete chaos all around us sometimes. I was doing just going over my notes last night, and I just so happened to say, you know, one day I want to go to Hawaii. I'm just thinking, it was one day I want to go to Hawaii. And what's going on in Hawaii? Wildfires going on there. I said, man, God, I'm glad to be here in Texas. You know, I don't need Hawaii no more. Let's go out east and do something different. It doesn't take much to see that there's complete chaos. And a guarding of peace is a place that you find a complete calm in the midst of a complete chaos. A complete calm in the midst of a complete chaos. You know, that could be a chair. Can be an office. That could be your car. But a garden of peace somewhere to where you can go in the midst of chaos and say, you know what, God, I can just feel you right here. You know, John Wesley's mother, you know, John Wesley was someone that was inside the Great Awakening, and his mother had over 15 children. And something that she did every day inside that house, she just put her apron over her head. And when she put her apron over her head, her kids knew, Mama's in her secret place. Don't talk to Mama right now. But that was her place where she spent time with God. Luke 22, verses 41 says this, talking about Christ. And when he withdrew from about a stone's throw, right before the crucifixion, Jesus knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not by my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, Jesus prayed more earnestly. Now, if Jesus withdrew to a place of peace, how much more should we withdraw? To have those places, to have those points in our lives to where you say, I have to meet this appointment. I need to step away from different things. You know, here's the tough part about it. Can we just be honest here in Texas this morning? Just because you're feeling tough doesn't mean you're not on the enemy turf. Just because you're feeling strong doesn't necessarily mean you don't need to pray for more strength. Can I say that once more? That just because you're feeling tough doesn't necessarily mean you're not on enemy turf, and just because you're feeling strong doesn't necessarily mean that you don't need to prepare for more strength. Look at verse 3 again. Look at the verse again. Verse 6, but when you pray, go to your room and when you have shut the door. Now, I think he wrote that to Southern people. I don't know what it is about us, but we'd like to have a porch. And we like to have that door open, don't we? Or at least unlocked. But the thing is this. He says, when you pray, go to your room. Go to that place and shut the door. Why do you need to shut the door? Well, it's simple. Because you don't need to let something else in that place with you sometimes. That in that place, sometimes everything and everybody else can't be in that place with you. Can I be honest about that? That you got to have your place to where you go. And sometimes other folks can't be in that place with you. That even though you say, okay, God, I can be in the midst of a situation that's chaos, in order for me to find my complete peace, I need to be a place where it's just me and you. Let me give you an illustration. I love sports. Absolutely love them. Doesn't look like it, but I actually really love sports. And when you have sports, you have a home team and a visiting team. And it's nice as believers for us to always believe that we're the home team, isn't it? We're the home team. But the truth is, sometimes it feels like we're the visiting team. And as the visiting team, you realize that, you know what, when we watch a football game or something's going on with the visiting team, what happens? They're trying to call plays, trying to get good reception, trying to hear what's going on, and the fans are going loud and crowd. Wow. Can't hear what's going on, so they're trying to throw up signals, and different things are just challenging for the visiting team. So they're trying to call the right play at the right time, at the right position, so they can try to score. And it gets so difficult because you have so much interference coming to where you can't hear what's really going on. So you realize that, you know what, I am tough, but I'm on the enemy's turf. So what the visiting team will do is they will stick it out so they get to halftime. When you get to halftime, you go back to the locker room. When you go in the locker room, you don't leave the door wide open. You close the door so you can talk to the coach and get a game plan together. Because what happened in the first half is going to be better the second half. Some of us have had some situations in our lives where you say, Brother Paul, you don't want to know my first half. But that's okay because now we're inside the locker room together. You see this right here? So when we have the door closed, we say, God, now will you talk to me? Will you tell me the game plan for the second half? When I know the second half, you realize, you say, you know what? The fans may be loud. The opposition may be high. But at the same time, I have a game plan because I've been inside my locker room, my secret place with God, to know that I know when I step back out there, I'm fully energized. I'm fully rested. I'm fully ready to go forth and do what God has told me to do. You have some situations in your life where you say, well, Brother Paul, I've been tough. I've been beat down. I've been worked on. But God's saying, when you go back to the secret place, if you go to the secret place, you realize that that's just your locker room. I got a game plan for you, but I need you to be able to hear what I have to say. In order for you to hear what he has to say, sometimes you got to close the door. And when you close the door, then you get that one-on-one lesson. You say, okay, so that's what I messed up. That's my job. Sometimes you get that instant replay where you say, okay, now when the defense comes at you again, it's no problem because I know what you're going to do, Satan. Amen. All right. Go to your garden of peace. Go to your locker room. C. Austin Miles wrote this. He said, you know, this guy, one day in March 1912, he was developing film, and while waiting on the process to complete, he picked up his Bible. And it just so happened to open up to John chapter 20, and he found this chapter and this story of Mary coming to the garden to visit the tomb of Jesus. And as she looked in the tomb, her heart sank because Jesus wasn't there. Do you remember the story? How Mary goes and doesn't see Jesus' body laying there. It just hit her right to the core. And as she looked in the tomb, her heart sank and sank and sank. But Jesus was actually nearby. He spoke to her, and she recognized him, and her heart leaped. Right then, C. Austin Miles imagined, he says, wait a minute. This isn't just a story from 2,000 years ago. This is right now. To where sometimes, God, I'm looking for you, and I don't see you, but you're standing right here with me the whole time that you've been walking with me and talking with me. And then from there, he composed the poem and said, I come to the garden alone where the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. The joy we share will tarry there. None other has ever known. I love that song. It's a garden of peace. In Daniel chapter 6, you know, when Daniel had, the Bible says that Daniel had done so many different things that were so well. I have a brother named Daniel, and I guess it's just something about the guys that are named Daniel. They really do the right thing at the right time. They just really do. When you name Paul, you do the wrong thing a lot of times. But I got a little competition. So there's Paul, we won't go there. There's Daniel, who's always done the right thing at the right time in both my parents' eyes. And praise God, we got a Stephen. So he messes up sometimes with me. So it's all right. But do you remember the story of Daniel? How the king had set him above different other people. And there was some jealousy going on there in chapter 6. And the king had set Daniel above. And so with the other people above him said, you know what? Let's make up a rule to kind of get Daniel in trouble. You know, Daniel's going through, he's going to always do the right thing. So let's make up a rule to do something to get Daniel in trouble. So they come up with this rule. They say, hey, king, you sure is a good king. You know what, king, you a great king. Matter of fact, king, you so good. Don't nobody else need to be praying, but nobody but to you. King said, you know what? That don't sound too bad, does it? He said, how long we should do that? Yeah, let's do that, king. He said, why don't you make a decree? He said, matter of fact, king, we don't just feel this way. Your whole kingdom feel this way. We all just need to pray to you. You so great, king. So the king signs a decree. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 6, verses 10, that says, now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened towards Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to God just as he had done before. But verse 11 says, then these men as a group went and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. They said, oh, we got him now. See, we made a decree, and King, you said that nobody else can pray, and we found Daniel praying. We got him now. So, of course, they throw him in the lion's den, and the king can't sleep, and he's going crazy. He's like, man, I can't believe I made this decree. How did these guys get me in this? And the Bible says, early in the morning, at first light, the king got up and hurried down to the lions. When he came near the den, he called to Daniel in an anguishing voice. It says, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve, continually been able to rescue from the lions? Verse 21 gets me pretty excited. It says, Daniel answered, may the king live forever. My God sent his angels. He shut the mouths of the lion. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight, nor have I done anything wrong before you, your majesty. You say, well, Brother Paul, what are you going from with this? Daniel, when he heard that there was a problem, there was some chaos going in the land, they made up a plot against him. And you know what Daniel does? He says, you know what? That's fine. I got a locker room. I got a secret place that I can go to. He goes to God and prays about it. So God gives him the game plan. He said, Daniel, I got you taken care of. Don't worry about what's going on. They catch Daniel praying. They throw him in the lion's den. But Daniel says, you know what, God? This is just part of your game plan. I'm okay. It may seem crazy, it may seem chaotic, but I got complete peace because I heard your game plan when I prayed about it earlier. Church, there's some times in our lives where you say, Paul, they're attacking me from the left, they're attacking me from the right, they're attacking me from the front, they're attacking me from the back. Then just stand there in the middle in your place of peace. Stand there and say, God, will you speak to me and give me the game plan? That way I don't know how to operate. And when things come at you from one way or things come at you from the other way, it's okay because we got a God that's omnipresent that can meet you right there in the middle.
Amen.
And change lives and situations. You got to be a genuine person if we want to hear God. But we got to go to our garden of peace. But let me give you one more entree, then I'll give you a dessert and we can go. You got to have the right gauge and principle. You got to be a genuine person. You got to have a garden of peace. But you got to have the correct gauging principle. Look at verse 7. He says, and when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, don't be like them, for your Father knows these things which you need before you ask him. Verse 7 again. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. We live in such a quantitative world. Would you agree to that? That everything's just being counted. And naturally, we measure success in the abundance of a subject or a substance. We live in such a quantitative world that we naturally measure success in the abundance of a substance. Just being honest with you, people measure things all the time. Students don't be this way, but I was not the best of students, and I had an English teacher one time that said, hey, you got to have a paper of 1,000 words. And she said, I won't even read it, Paul, if it's not 1,000 words. So I wrote up a good paper. I thought it was a good paper. And she gave it right back and said, it's not 1,000 words. I said, did you read it? She said, I told you, I'm not going to read it unless it's 1,000 words. So you know what I did? I'm out of school now, so I'm just going to tell the truth now. I must have went home. I copied all that what I wrote, just hit the double, and I doubled it up, and I wrote turned the same thing in twice. And so had the same paper, just one on top of each other. Got an A. She never read it. She measured it by the quantity, not by the quality. I love that teacher after that, I tell you. But we do that, don't we? We measure success by the abundance of a subject. Points on the scoreboard determine the winner. We measure success by the abundance of a substance. Dollars in the bank account determines the success of that bank account. How much do you actually have? Or square foot on a house determines how big that house is, sometimes determines how successful we are. Or can we take it back to Texas? Do you have a V6 or a V8 motor in that truck? We count to see how this is. And here's the danger. Here's the danger of it. Sometimes even inside the church. People in the pews. While all these things are good, we must be careful of the vain repetition. It's not just repeating yourself, but in certain translations, it might use the word babbling. Just going on and on and on and on with no substance to what you're actually saying. You're feeding it just fluff, fluff, fluff. You know, when we had a chili cook-off, and I won't go into that competition. I think everybody does a great job here. But someone told me this once. I asked them, I said, how come? I said, we have a chili cook-off at our church. Why don't you compete? Because it had a really good chili. It had a really good chili. And he says, Paul, I only compete with people that are professionals. I said, well, why is that? He said, because technically real chili has nothing in there but just meat. Everything else is just fluff. Sometimes we measure so much by the substance that we forget the depth of something. Can I give you a biblical illustration? In 1 Kings chapter 18, Elijah is at Mount Carmel, and he's challenging the prophets of Baal. The Bible says that Elijah says, okay, let's have a competition. I'll be on one side, you be on the other side, and whoever's God rains down fire is the true God. So he let the prophets of Baal go first. The Bible says they called on the name Baal from morning till noon. That's a long time to call. I would need a water break after a while. They said, Baal, answer us. They shouted, but there was no response. No one answered. And then they danced around the altar they had made. Then at noon, I guess Elijah had had enough of it. He probably had took a break, a siesta and everything else, and woke up, and they were still shouting for Baal. So Elijah said, shout louder. Surely he's a god. He's teasing them, right? He said, perhaps he's in a deep thought, or maybe he's busy, or he's traveling, or maybe he's sleeping, needs to be awakened. And so they're getting frustrated because they've been calling on this with vainless words, with babbling repetition for all morning. Now we're into the afternoon. And so they shouted louder. And then watch what they did. They started cutting themselves with swords and spears to blood flow. Midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time of the evening sacrifice. But there was no response. No one answered, and no one paid attention. 12 hours of yelling, screaming, cutting, dancing. But they had two things wrong. Number one, they were calling to the wrong God. And number two, they were calling for the wrong goals. Calling to the wrong God and calling for the wrong goals. When Jesus says, when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they think they will be heard for their many words. In their minds, they say, okay, God, in order for this to be successful, I got to say X amount. I'm measuring by this quantity, not necessarily the quality. So the question turns into, well, how does God measure? 1 Samuel 16 says this, but the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at his heart. It's not the quantity of words we say, but it's the depth of the heart that we pour out. It's not the quantity of words we say, but it's the depth of our heart that we pour out to him. You know, football is different from any other sport because it's the same size field everywhere you go. It's all measured by the same way. You know, you look at basketball, baseball. Baseball is the same around the diamonds, but the outfield may be a little bit different. But football is always the same. There's a universal unit of measurement that is applied to the zone of opportunity. In order for this to be successful, all parties must comply to that measurement. In order for us to be, if you look at a football team and they say, okay, it's 100 yards long, but another team says, well, we're just going to go by inches today. How successful is that team going to be? Not very successful. They have to realize when the team comes onto the field that I have to go by the rule or the yardstick that the game is being played by. As believers, we have to come to the kingdom of God, the grace of God, the presence of God, saying, God, what is your yardstick? What do you measure things by? Jesus is telling us here, I don't measure it by how many words you say, but I measure it by your heart that you're pouring out. Let me give you an illustration. Abraham spoke when God visited him in chapter 18. He says, Jesus is talking, and he had told Abraham that his wife was going to have a child. And verse 23 says, and Abraham came near, and Jesus is saying, or the angel of the Lord at the time, which is Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. Jesus says, okay, I've told you about your wife, but let me also tell you about what I'm about to do next. And Abraham came near and says, you know, would you destroy the righteous with the wicked? So he asked God a question. Now, I want you to hear the repetition here. Abraham says, okay, God, you're about to go destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, but would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? So Abraham says, suppose there were 50 righteous within the city. Would you also destroy that place and not spare it for 50 that were in it? He said, far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay righteous with the wicked so that the righteous would be as the wicked. Far be it from you, shall not the judge of the earth do right? So the Lord said, if I find 50 righteous within the city, I will spare all the place for their sakes. But then Abraham said, indeed now, who am I but dust and ashes have taken upon myself to speak to the Lord? Suppose there were 5 less than 50. Would you destroy all the city for lack of 5? He said, if I find there 45, I will not destroy it. And then he says, okay, again, Lord, suppose there were 45. So he said, I will not destroy it for 40. Then he said, okay, let the Lord not be angry. I will speak, suppose there be 30 found. And he said, indeed, I found myself speaking to the Lord. Suppose there be less than that. He says, will you destroy if you had 20? I would not destroy for 20. He said, then he said, let the Lord, please don't be angry with me, but let me speak one more. Suppose 10 will be found. And the Lord says, I will not destroy it for the sake of 10. Abraham went on and on and on, started at 50 and worked his way down. But his words weren't babbling. It was the outcry of his heart. That's the difference. It wasn't just measuring off to say, okay, God, I just got to count this many words when I pray to you. He said, no, God, I got to keep praying to you till I get it all out of my system. That there's something still left that I need to pour out to you. That's the application. You know, I would love to see a revival break out. I would love to see the house of God full. I would love to see God's vision take over this place. I enjoy seeing people. But we can't forget about the power of one. If I measure everything in the quantity and forget about the power of one, then I've missed it. We've missed it. You know, 1 Timothy 2:5 says this. Think about the power of one. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Romans 5:18 says this. Therefore, by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation. Even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinner, by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Luke 15 says, I say to you likewise that there shall be joy all in heaven over one sinner that repented more than the 99 just persons that need no repentance. Church, I love to see certain successes, and just naturally in my flesh as a person, we want to count certain things, but we do ourselves a disservice when we forget about the power of one. That God measures things by the heart, not just by the quantity. You got to be a genuine person. You got to go to your garden of peace. You got to have the right gauging principle to measure. But I'm going to challenge you last to be a praying giant. You know, a giant is a personification of the word gigantic. A giant is usually bigger than the things around them. And you say, okay, Paul, you're saying pray like a giant and look at you. I said, I know. And the truth is, can we just be honest here for a second? Just be honest just for a second here. Sometimes it's hard to pray like a giant when the problems around you seem bigger than you are. Have you been there? Sometimes it's hard to pray like a giant when the problems around you seem bigger than you are. And what these objects around us, what they do, these large things, is they block our reception sometimes. And the only way we can get reception is to get above it, to stand on the shoulders. If I told you, one of the courtesies we do as speakers or anybody up on the stage, you always put your phone on silent, right? That's kind of the unwritten rule. You got to put your phone on silent. But if this thing just kept going off, and I said, okay, church, I'm so sorry. I'm just keep getting a phone call. I said, yes, Mr. Jones. He says, Paul, how you praying for my Cowboys this year? I said, well, Mr. Jones, we're talking about prayer right now in service. Can I call you right back? Yeah, Paul, call me back anytime. You'd look at me and say, okay, at first I was mad that you picked up the phone, but since it's Jerry Jones, and it's almost that time of the year, Paul, tell him to do something about Dak's interceptions, right? But here's the thing, church. A phone call from the owner of the Cowboys doesn't compare to a conversation with Jesus. Doesn't compare. What does the song say? What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Amen. That when you feel, you say, how do I become bigger than what I am? And the truth is, sometimes it's a little bit tough. Sometimes it's hard to pray like a giant. Sometimes it's hard to see past the objects, to see past the opposition, to see past the difficulties, the things that are pressing against you. But watch what Jesus does. The Bible says that in bringing, Hebrews chapter 2 says, in bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. Both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are the same family. Say that again. Both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers or sisters. Jesus says in Matthew 18, 20, for where two or three are gathered in my name, I'm in the midst. So for me, I said, okay, God, help me understand this. How do I pray like a giant? When I'm at the bottom of the bottom, I have to always realize that I'm not by myself. Amen. When you walk into the Walker household, you don't just walk in to see me, but you walk in to see my family. When I walk into your house, I don't just walk in just to see you, but I walk in to see everything that your house represents. Would you agree to that there? So at the same time, when I think about praying, and when I'm going through certain situations in my life or I'm praying for my children, I say, wait a minute, I'm not just praying for my children, but I look at Kenesha and say, okay, we're praying for our children. So at that time, I said, you know what, sweetheart, when we have something that feels like it's taller than us, how about this? How about I lift you up on my shoulders? And when I lift you up on my shoulders, now you got one guy who's 5'0" and another woman who's 5'0", but then together we become 10 feet. Does that make sense there? So what you do is, as a family, as a whole, you say, okay, how do we pray like giants? You don't pray as giants by yourself, because by yourself, you only got a certain limit to you. But when you put somebody on your shoulders, you see a different viewpoint, a different vantage, and you reach a different height. What Sunday school does and what church does is put you in a group of people that you realize that, you know what, sometimes the opposition seems bigger than what you are. Would you agree to that there? But when you have a group of people that's with you, that's willing to pray for you, to stand with you, to put you on their shoulders when you don't feel like standing no more, then you can pray like a giant. Because then you can see things that you couldn't see before. You get a vantage points that you couldn't be before. And that's the beauty of it. I think of like the clouds. You know, a cloud is just a droplet. But there's a million of them together. One little droplet. But there's so many millions of them together. Create a cloud. Hebrews 12 says this. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. You're not by yourself. You say, how do I pray like a giant? You join the cloud. Say, God, I just want to be a droplet. And will you put me together with people that will pray with me, to lift me up, to surround me? You know, the beautiful part about a cloud produces an overcast. An overcast is something that you see when you look up and it covers the sky. You see it everywhere. The overcast produces a overshadow. So a cloud produces an overcast. The overcast produces an overshadow. The overshadow produces something called an overflow. So you got an overcast that produces an overshadow. And when the overshadow fills up, what happens is it fills up with condensation or precipitation, and it comes down to an overflow. Does that make sense there? So we have an overcast, which turns into an overshadow. The overshadow turns into an overflow. The overflow is something that God pours into us that cannot be undermined by the enemy. When you say, well, Paul, how do I become that person? Realize that Jesus said, I called you brothers. I called you sisters. I called you so you can join this family. And when you say, when I join this family, then you can pray and say, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's a family thing. It's a family thing. You got to be a genuine person You got to go to your garden of peace. But you say, Brother Paul, I'm trying to go to my garden of peace, and I'm struggling with that, or I'm trying to be a genuine person. Sometimes I find myself, or I'm not measuring my prayers the right way. Or I want to be a praying giant. You know, the beautiful thing about that story, the man goes home, and he realizes that his wife's yelling at him, and she said, okay, I have an issue. I have a problem. So the wife goes back with the man to the doctor. And he says, Doc, I realized something. It was not my wife. It's me. It's me. And the doc says, well, most of the time it is. Most of the time it is. He said, what's the problem? He said, I'm not hearing. I want to hear her. But I'm not hearing. I'm being genuine about it. I genuinely love my wife. I go to my garden of peace with her. I date her. I treat her right. And I'm gauging it correctly. I'm loving her the right way. I'm pouring out my heart. And I'm trying to be this husband, this giant for her. But I can't hear. He said, that's why we have hearing aids. We have something to help you hear even when things are tough. As a believer, this is your hearing aid. When you can't hear no more and you're tired and you're down, this is your hearing aid. You say, God, I'm praying, I'm doing all these things, and I don't know. This is your hearing aid. This is your hearing aid. Will you stand with me? You know, maybe that's you. Maybe you say, well, Paul, that's me. I'm not hearing God like I want to hear God. I'm not hearing God like I want to hear God. Perhaps you'd like to come forward and say, you know what, I need a relationship with Christ. That's where it starts. Or maybe you say, I need a church home. Or maybe you just say, I'm not hearing God like I want to hear God. I want to hear Him more. And I'm not going to say, God, it's you. Maybe it's me. As Brother Michael sings, if you'd like to come down and pray, you're more than welcome to.
I come to the garden alone while the dew's still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the song of God discloses, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Our pastor always closes with this. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to Aaron, his son, saying this, in this way you shall bless the children of Israel. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in peace and hear the voice of God this week. Amen.
Thank you for joining us online today. We are so glad that you were a part of the service. If you have any questions about what it means to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, about baptism, or how to join our family at Central Baptist Church, we would love to answer your questions. You can use Facebook Messenger to send us a message, or you can call or email the church. You will find our phone and email information on our website. Thank you again for worshiping with us today, and may God bless you and give you peace.